Vinci, do you want to get started on that?
What is the proper sticks and mallets?
Proper grip.
Grip. Oh, yeah. Grip. Okay,
proper
I see.
Grip for sticks and mallets.
So, as always, we're going to start with snare drum. Mm. Snare drum is like the basic of all of the percussion instruments. So for me, I would take like 1/3. Yeah. We'll find a balance of the stick. So there's a guideline for it. So it will be like 1/3 of the stick. Mostly it will be at the one close to the butt of the stick. Yeah. And then you play with it, whether you go hold it like a little bit lower, and then you try a little bit higher, and then you can find the balance that you like, that is comfortable for you. So every stick has different weight and different length. Yeah, so it has all a different feel. So it depends on the individual. So I would say like mostly on in generally, you can like, it's like here, in general.
Yeah.
See,
what about Suyan? What do you think about this?
So I agree with Nian Shee, but the 1/3 guideline is not necessarily like rocket science, because like some sticks are longer and some sticks are shorter. So if we are talking about 1/3, right? So it really depends on where you feel comfortable holding it. So the 1/3 would be a starting guideline. You put your hand there, and then another little tip that I will use is I put a little finger in front of the stick, and I'm holding this thing with two fingers, not really like putting any pressure, just holding there. So if you are too behind, like towards the butt, you see the sticks is going downwards, and if you are holding too front, the sticks is going upwards, which is not helpful for us, because we want to use as much weight from the sticks to play, so that we can do less work and let the sticks do the work. So what I will do is I will hold the place that normally give us a very straight sticks without putting pressure. So don't do this. This is cheating. Yeah, it's just like put there. Yeah. So like this is still a bit, somewhere here. This is where I will feel comfortable playing, but everybody is different. So like, if you feel more comfortable this way, go ahead and do it. Because like, even though this is my general grip place, but I will move accordingly. Like, let's say if I'm playing something very loud and I don't want to use my own strength and I have my sticks to help me and gravity as our good friends, I'll just put my sticks more behind. So the sticks will do the work for me.
So generally, the 1/3 will be a guideline, but it's most important to find a comfortable position for you to hold the sticks, right?
Yep.
All right, I think another common question that students usually ask, so this will usually apply to, what do we call it, match grip? What about traditional grip? How then would you, yeah.
Especially in a lot of marching bands, they will use traditional grip, but not all the students will understand right away how to use the traditional grip. So what do you guys have think about learning the left hand traditional grip?
Okay, to be honest, I learned traditional grip when I was back in school band, taught by my senior. And then we were taught to hold the stick somewhere around the same place as where you hold the right hand. And you clip it inside, you put your two fingers there, turn around and you play, right? And that was the only instruction that I got. And then now I only use traditional grip to play bass drum roll, because this is much easier to play. In concert setting, I never play traditional grip, because I practice this way all the time. And I don't use this, because if these are matching and easy, I just have to learn one way. Why do I bother to learn another way? But that's just my thought. My teacher, one of my teachers in Pittsburgh, he plays traditional grip simply because he learned it that way. And then the only tip he taught me playing traditional grip on the bass drum is, last time I used to play like this, I'm like wiggle my finger and then put it down like that. But he told me to twist my wrist and my arm, because that gave me more strength. But that was when we played bass drum, because bass drum beater is like very heavy, very big. Let me grab one and show you.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, it's like this big. So if you are using your finger, it doesn't really work. So my teacher got me to like twist my arm with it. Yeah.
Nishi, what
about
you?
I'm not very familiar with it.
Oh, how about me? I don't really actually learn how to play with traditional Greek. So as I remember, when I got into like high school, when I'm in Form 1, like we're still juniors, and then we're still learning like how to read notes and the Greeks and all that. And then like our seniors just taught us how to play with match Greek. Yeah, like we started with match Greek. And then by that time, like my seniors they are like all playing the side drums, which
we
find traditional Greek. So, but the year after, our schools got high tensions, which is at the front. So I don't really have to learn how to play with the traditional groups. So sometimes we just like play for fun and that's all.
How relevant do you sorry? Yeah, you want to add on?
So a lot of students would think that if I play this way, I'm the correct way, or this way is the correct way. Yeah. I just want to say, in the percussion world, we never talk about the correct way or the wrong way. As long as the way works for you, that's the correct way for you. Okay. So you can play it this way or this way, as long as you make the sound that works. Yeah.
I guess that kind of answers my question, because I wanted to ask, which way do you think, you know, it's more relevant in today's setting? Well, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good, good. All right. So now, does this grip apply? So it applies to playing the snare drum, right? Does it apply to many, you know, other percussion instruments that you play as well? Is it a universal method that you can apply accordingly? Or is there a different method for, like, say, a different way of gripping, say, like, you know, a timpani mallet, or, you know, those that you use to play keyboard percussion?
Yeah, because there's a lot of schools of thought when it comes to timpani. Like, they throw around terms like French grip, German grip, American grips. So which grip do you guys usually use for timpani?
The useful grip. I think that is also depending on what mallets are you using. Depending on the mallets that you're using. If you're using like a bamboo shaft, I think you don't even have to like hold it all. My Tiffany mallets is next door. Okay, so the one that I've got. So with the bamboo,
he's talking about this.
So the bamboo one will be like mostly use the called the first three fingers. Okay, so for me, I'm using the
carbon fiber.
Yeah, the carbon fiber, the one that Asian has on her hand. So for that one, when I'm using that, I'll be using a lot of wrist.
Okay.
Yeah, a lot of wrist instead of fingers.
Exercises
for
it really depends on the weight of the stick and what sound you want to make, right?
Yes, and also it feels different for different sounds.
That's interesting. There's also another commonly asked question. It has got to do with grips, but not for mallets and sticks. It's how do you cymbals are usually very heavy, right? So how do I, you know, play them effectively? And if you have to hold them for long hours, and you know, even though you get to rest them on the stand sometimes. How do you, Suyen, do you want to give us some insight on that?
So first of all, if you have a choice to use a lighter cymbals, go ahead.
Yes.
If the lighter cymbals work for you, why go for the heavier one? But I would choose the heavier because it makes the sound that I want. So to be able to play the heavier kind of cymbals, like both of us now are not like very, very big people. So we actually exercise, work out.
Yeah.
Even for me, I do yoga, she work out.
Wow.
Yeah, workout actually helps though to take the to take up the
we got some stuff here. Like.
Yeah. It does help.
In that case, what kind of exercise do you guys recommend for percussionists, especially the younger students, to help them to carry the cymbals better?
Exercise.
I would say for warm up, you can do it as you warm up when you get those cymbals. Feel the weight, and then you can try to like do like a dumbbell thingy, and then I don't know, like try try like everything different angles and to feel the weight, like
I've seen students holding the cymbals and then doing
for me, like,
this will hurt your hands, please don't do that.
Oh, okay, so don't do that.
I think they put the strap around, right? And then do it on the lighter cymbal, because the way you turn the cymbal, we don't do it in concert percussion. I think only the marching band, they do it during drum line.
Yes.
Right. Yeah, so it's more for showy stuff, and those kind of cymbals are normally the lighter one.
Yes.
Yes. All right. Okay. Thank you for that. So now that we know how to, you know, hold our sticks, what is the proper form and posture that a percussionist should have? Say, for, you know, sitting down and standing while you're playing. Let's try maybe the snare drum. So what is the proper posture?
Proper posture. So like first of all, rule number one: always get comfortable. Get comfortable. And then for me, like a lot of people, they would say things like, you put your drum right in front of you. Of course, if I'm having a drum here, I'll make sure like my snare is right in front of me so that I can turn on and off the snare easily without finding it. Yeah. And then I will have my drum head around this height around here, because I feel most comfortable playing here. But of course you can experiment putting it higher and see your hand position and putting it lower and see which one you feel most comfortable and easy to play stuff. Yeah, because we have to play a lot of very hard stuff. So to make our job easier, we just make everything easier for us first. And then I would say like just go comfortable. My way of playing for posture, I would say like, I'll put my sticks at both sides of my thigh and then use the tip to guide my hand up and then meet that point on top of the drum head. And then my playing point is never the middle, because that's the dead spot, unless it's specifically asked by the composer, or else I will not play here. I'll play more towards the closer to the rim there, but not right outside. Yeah, because when we play, we do move around to get the sound that we want.
Yeah.
So you just put your stick there, move. And then there are methods saying that we have to do it 90 degrees, like 90 degrees here. But I don't feel comfortable this way because look, my arm are like locked.
Yeah.
So the 90 degree will work for some people and might not work for a lot of people. And for me, I find this easier. And I stand in a very lazy way. Instead of standing up straight like this, when I play snare drum, I'm actually like that. Because it makes me feel comfortable. But I'm not saying that you should do it this way, but you should give it a try and see whether it works for you.
So Yan, just now you mentioned not playing in the center of the drum. Why is that so? Why do you not play right in the center?
So like, imagine like, do you people understand how does the drum head mount on top of a drum? I mean let's say if you have a snare drum like here, so it's, imagine like you have a bottle and like a big bottle with a big mouth opening, you put a tissue on top of it and then you tie a rubber band around it and then you pull, which part is most likely to break first?
It's the center, right?
Yeah, that's the same concept on the on the drum, because you have the drum head here and then you have all these lugs tying things down. So this part has the most tension. I mean, this is a drum head, it doesn't work that way. That's the part that's easiest to break in.
Try
to avoid it.
So some percussionists, when they play snare drum, right, especially when they play traditional grip, some of their band directors ask them to tilt their snare drum so that it feels more natural for them. Do you agree with that, actually?
Yes, because if you play traditionally, right, you see I'm holding my stick like this. If I want to play like that, I feel more comfortable if I go this way. It works more naturally if I tilt my my head is going to drop. Never mind, something like that. I mean, it looks more natural because my stick is tilting that way. But if I'm going to play like this, see, is there a problem?
Yeah, it is because of the bending of the sticks.
Nishi, what about you? What do you do when you, you know, try to set up and make sure that you're in a comfortable position? So what are the, any other, you know, tips and tricks that you usually
use? Okay, I'll say for me, I'll be standing straight. Okay, and then I'll stand like, open my feet widely a little bit so that I'll like stay grounded to the ground.
So that
I'll get the support. So I'll just like stand straight and then, yeah. So make sure you don't use the wrong muscles and all that as well. So I have like back to support my limbs. Yeah.
What about when sitting down, Yanshi? What do you do when you sit down and play, especially so on drum set?
I'll try to sit straight as I could. So I won't hunch.
Yeah, I think that will give us back pain.
It's the same one except when I'm sitting down or standing. Mm. Yeah, like upper body
would
be the same.
All right. Thank you so much for that. Now that we're able to, you know, hold a stick, sit down or stand, let's talk about basic strokes and rolls. Yeah. So let's just talk about maybe playing the snare drum. How do we execute, you know, the four basic strokes? And what are the four basic strokes?
Yeah, the four basic strokes like the is something that's thrown around a lot, like the full stroke, the rebound stroke, the tap stroke, and the up stroke. So like, what do you guys think about those four types of stroke and how important it is? How about Nishi, you can start.
Okay, first of all, you need to know like, how do they work? Like full stroke is like up and down at the same height, okay? Downstroke is up to down, you play and then you stay there. Okay, for up stroke, you will do a tap first and then you go up. And then the last one is the tap one. You just stay low and then you play tap small for like a softer or a softer passage. Yeah. So for first of all, you know all that. But actually, when you have your music, let's say you have accent, and then let's say you have four quivers. You have first note accent. So da 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 da. Okay. Da 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 da. And then when you repeat that, like looping that rhythm. Da. Okay, so you are actually using first one will be the full stroke, I guess. Full and then tap up, full or down. So you decide. It's up to you whether you want to get like a nice full sound or you want like a forced sound.
So the last quiver will be an up because you have to create like a more preparatory for the next one, right?
Yes.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Sometimes like students know, like they do it because it's like a instinct. Like you know that you have to play
exactly.
It out. Just bring it up, but it's actually a tough. It's just a
yeah.
Difficult.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So how do you guys actually do you teach them as isolated strokes or do you, you know, in the beginning and then you combine them into exercises for students to do, or do you work based on instinct like you said, like. Like, do you let them try it out first and you tell them, this is what stroke, that is what stroke? Suyin?
For me, like, I depends on how old is the student and how long do they have time to prepare for stuff. Like, if you are, like, a school band student and you have very limited time to practice or rehearse and then you have to prepare, like, pieces for concerts, now right away, jump straight, go straight, do like this, like that, for them to imitate words sometimes. And then while they could do it or while they are doing it, maybe point out, oh, this is actually the dead stroke or down stroke, this is actually the up stroke. There are three types. But if I have a student that like around your age, like young teenager, then maybe we can talk about all this detail. You see, this is the full stroke you do, and then we do a few strokes, and then we do exercises on full strokes, and then we talk about the down strokes, we talk about the up strokes, then we put them together, we do phlegm and stuff, we can do the step-by-step things. But then if we are teaching younger children, where understanding all these kind of like words are like, huh, they will have this kind of reaction. Of course, they will deal with the playing first.
Then
only point out what is it, or maybe we don't even touch the downstroke, upstroke yet. We will just focus on the full stroke, understand the rhythm, make good sound, have fun. Yeah.
Very good points. Yeah. So it really depends on the age of the students that you're saying, right? And also sometimes it's not just the age, but like how fast someone picks something up as well. I think that would help. So educators out there, there's no one size that fits all. But yeah, it really depends on the situation as well. Yeah. All right. So I think learning the strokes, right? But one of the common issues that a lot of band students actually face is the roles. So imagine like when you're in a marching band or even in a concert band, you get to play a lot of roles. And what are the tips in making a good even role? And what are the things that band directors should look out for in a good role? Yinqi, what do you have to say about that?
Okay, first of all, why composer writes role? Because they want that sound to be sustained. Long tone, because as a percussionist, we cannot play a long tone because our instrument just have one sound. Top. That's all. That's it,
yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah. So that's why they wrote like a role, so that they want a sustained sound. Sustained sound. Okay. Yeah. So to practice for that one, so it also depending on like if you want to make it a double stroke role or buzz role. Yeah. So they have like a different approach. Like for buzz role, you press down as much as you can. As sustaining as you can.
I was hungry.
Yeah, so you press down. So you will do right hand, you do a few times, and then you feel, so you do a few times, you get the length or the pressure, and also you listen to the role that you want to achieve. So once you get the correct one, you remember how it feels in your hand. Yeah, okay. You need to remember, oh, that's a good one. Okay, I need to try to, try to find it back and then do, yeah. Okay, yeah. So start with the right hand and then you do the left hand. Okay, do the left hand and then you try to match the sound that you want, the one that you get. Yeah, and then you overlap. So to practice roll, you practice it slowly first. You do burr until it is done. Burr, burr. Yeah. So if you're going to do alternate hands, so you do 1, 2. 1, 2. So your left hand will go down before the right hand ends. So that is how we carry on the room.
Okay.
Yeah. And then slowly you will add 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 3 strokes. Yeah. You start with the right hand and then the next one will be starting with the left hand. You don't cheat, right? Just starting with your hands. You need to train your weak hand as well. So 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and then 4, 5, and so on. Yeah. So and then you can get along nice.
See, so you want to demonstrate a bit, like when it's played fast, how does it sound like? This is a bass roll, right?
Yeah. Yes, bass roll.
Bass roll. Okay.
Bass roll.
But it's about overlapping the sound.
All right. Yeah.
Two different sounds. Yeah.
Yeah. What was the other role that you were mentioning just now?
The double stroke roll. Double stroke roll is like, so when you play down, you need to have 2 sounds instead of as much as you want. Double stroke roll is 1 stroke, you've got 2 sounds. Yeah.
So would you say bass stroke is actually, what do you call like a multiple stroke roll? Is it the same thing?
Yeah, it is. It's the same thing. So I think so I think a lot of like marching percussion students, like when they play snare drum or tenor, they usually want to build a faster double stroke roll because in the percussion we all love to play fast. So what tips do you guys have for them to play a faster double stroke?
Faster double stroke.
Why do you want it that fast though? What's the purpose of it? Show off. Because maybe some of them want to show off, but maybe sometimes in their show music, it calls for like a faster roll,
Faster roll. Because like, the intention of writing roll is to play open, to make a sustaining sound, right? It's a long tone. So like I understand like in marching style, we do play open roll, the double stroke roll, so that it sounds like more, you hear every single note, every single grains going on. And then buzz roll is more of the concert way to do it.
Yeah.
So you have a more like a long tone thing. But that, I do understand that in marching style, sometimes we require to play very fast because it's just the nature of showing off, right? Because when you're out there, you're showing off. So I think to be able to play fast, you gotta start slow first, of course. Get a metronome. Metronome is a good friend. Mm-hmm. Always have metronome with you. You can download it for free in the app. Yeah, and then just like work your way up. Yeah. Mm. So if, of course, because the double stroke roll is still a long tone, so if start to if it starts to sound like this, it sounds like a lot of notes going on. So just go comfortable, check your tempo, like maybe go 3 or 4 clicks faster, then do it again. Mm. And then if you feel like let's say up to a point you feel like your right hand or your dominant hand might be left hand can go faster but your other hand is not going faster, then stop at that tempo, work on your weaker hand and then build it up and then until they match and then can make that sustaining sound and then you move higher again.
Yeah.
But always work with the metronome now because to play the role nicely, especially open role, you have to make sure that you have a consistent sound. So meaning your double saw shouldn't be like too wide or too close together. All of them should be evenly spaced out. Yeah.
Ah, evenly spaced out. Yeah. I mean, while we're on that topic, right, it's actually, so this is actually connected to our next main topic, which is rhythm and daily training. There's a commonly asked question. So both of you have been in bands before, right? So the question actually is, how important are rudiments, learning rudiments in a band, as like in a school band? Yeah, Nian Shee. Did you guys learn rudiments?
Teach your students all the 40 basic rudiments? Like,
No. I don't think we teach all of them. But we will teach the one that is commonly used.
Mm.
Commonly used, which is the 5 strokes rows, 7 strokes rows, 9, 11, 13, and all that strokes rows. And also the flam tab, paradiddle, flam paradiddle.
Oh, yeah. So you guys actually learned that in school last time?
Not in school though.
Oh, not in school, okay.
But if you can learn it by yourself, it actually helps. Yeah, sometimes it can save you from playing. Okay, I'll give an example. So if you have an excerpt or a piece to play, to play on the timpani. So let's say you have 4 drums to play.
Yeah.
Okay, so the composer will not like think of, okay, they won't think of the how would you play, like how which hand you're gonna play, like 4 drums. You have 4 drums. You need to like switching around, crossing and all that. So sometimes we use paradiddle to shift our leading hand. Yeah. So for example, if you're going to play from right to left, so let's say you have 2 notes. Right, left. Okay, so when you want to change, shift to the other, you want to go to the different directions, sometimes you have to do like a double so that you will go up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, with the you will lead with a different hand.
Yeah. One thing I want to point out about the naming of the rudiments, did you guys realize that how smart percussionists are or drummers? Because if you say, let's say like we are doing a single paradiddle, means paradiddle one time, right? Para means different hand, diddle same hand. Paradiddle. And then if you are doing a 5-stroke roll, it's actually 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You are doing 7-stroke roll, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Yeah.
Or let's say you are doing a flam. Is a flum sound. If you're doing a drag, it's a drag sound. Drag.
Oh, you never thought of it that way.
It's actually that's how it was named. So like if you're saying like all the more advanced one, like the further down in the number of the rudiment chart, like let's say flam tap, it's actually flam tap. That's how it's made.
Wait, there's one I wanted to ask. There's something called what, retamacu. I don't know how to pronounce that one.
Retamacu.
Retamacu. Oh, that's a different story. Okay. Yeah. So it's nothing to do with sound.
Most of them work this way. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Just like the Swiss Army triplets.
As in general, you would recommend students to actually, if they can or their own time, pick up a few of the basic rudiments. Would you say that's the case? Like to learn a bit, yeah, right? Yeah. So okay. In terms of like seniors in school, all right, would you recommend that they teach these kind of things to the students as well? Or like even, you know, band directors, ensure that they allocate, you know, a bit of time to work on these kind of exercises or whatever that bands are currently doing. So just, you know, take up piece and then play and then work on like really basic single strokes and stuff.
In a snare drum piece, you will definitely, I won't say definitely, most probably you are going to see phlegm. You're most probably going to see drag, accent, and then those diddle thing, it's more like a sticking thing. So it depends on, if you are work on rudiments, you are very good at like playing single paradiddle sound, like playing single stroke, then you'll have more freedom to play, like use different kind of sticking to play that piece that make you feel more comfortable. It's like you have more tool in your toolbox. But then like we don't skip phlegm, we do not skip drag, we do not skip rough, because those are the things that are used in music. But we won't skip roll. Five stroke roll, because if you skip five stroke roll and you're in a marching band, how are you going to do the drum thing, yeah? The first thrap thing? If you can't play five stroke roll, what are you going to do? Like that. You're going to work. So maybe you do it and you do not know it's called five stroke roll. Most of the time that's the face that.
By doing the five-stroke roll, you know like how it works. It also helps you to keep time, because you know how the rhythm works, and then you know, oh, now I'm at the second quiver, and now I'm at the end of the
Fair point. All right. So the next common question related to rhythm and daily training, right? It's there are so many things in a percussion section, and so many different instruments to learn. How do I practice for all of them, and where do I start?
Especially since all the percussion instruments in the percussion family, they require different skills. Like learning how to play timpani is different from like keyboard. So how would you guys suggest that students make sure that they have all the skills needed so that they can play all this well? Maybe you want to start.
Okay, so students need to like explore. Like they have to like play all the instruments if they wanted to learn. Like they have to try out. They have to feel the instrument. They have to like. Because like a timpani drum and a snare drum is different. Different sound and all that. So like, so if you want to be able to play all of them, you need to play it. Yes, you need to play it for yourself. You can't just like, I talk, everyone can talk. You need to do it by yourself and then you'll know, oh, this feels differently. Yeah, it won't be the same way because of the nature of the drum, the material are different.
So they have to go through everything. But how about Suyin?
I would say like to play percussion is more like, it's not like a task that you have to do because you have a playground to play with. I would say we would just play on everything and explore, because as a child, you play with everything and then make fun of it, right? I mean, have fun with it. But then for serious training, I would say we all start on snare drum first, because like let's say if you are playing keyboard instruments, the way we hold the sticks is pretty much the same or similar. Like to be able to do your two hands like that evenly is a very important thing for all percussion playing, right? So snare drum would be a good start. If you don't happen to own a pair of sticks, just doing this would work. Use your hands and make sound would work as well. But then snare drum, for me, I think snare drum is the starting point, but it's also one of the hardest to master because it has so many things to do with it.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to sound very delicate. It's a loud instrument, but you have to make it sound delicate sometimes. Yeah. So snare drum is definitely the instrument that I will practice every day. And then for mallets, there are so many of them. They are made with different materials, using different mallets, different kind of materials. But the simple, what do you call it? The basic method is pretty much the same. But then once you are on a xylophone, you are on a harder surface, hitting a harder surface, it feels different. You use more wrist, you use wrist, and then in the marimba, you have a softer surface, like hitting a softer part. Then it just feels different, and then like it's very hard to say how do I play marimba nicely. You just grab your mallet, play on it, just explore, just play. Eventually it sounds nicer. Also, when you play, make sure you listen to your own playing. If you feel like I'm playing so good and that it sounded you are going to break the marimba,
I think one thing that a lot of bands actually tend to neglect is that percussion instruments actually also have what we call tone. As in that we focus a lot of that in like wind instruments, but we don't talk enough about, you know, having a good tone on percussion instruments, right? Is that what you have experienced as well, Nian Shee? No. Very
what?
Different. As in, talking about like tone.
Tone color.
Tone color.
Yeah.
Tone color. Yeah. Is there something that you learn only as you go on, you know, like further in your, study life, like in the instrument itself? Or does that make sense? Yeah.
Yes, further, but I think that when I was in high school, so I'll listen to the music. And then whatever sound that I produce, it has to be in context. Maybe that time I do not know like how I do it. I just listen to it. Oh, that feels good, and that feels together with other people. And yeah, and then I'll just go for it. And then no one says anything, so okay, I'll go for it.
So would you say that the tone of how you play your instrument should really complement what the winds are playing? Is that another way to put it?
It depends on your role. Like, let's say you are the timekeeper. Let's say if you are playing marches, and then the bass drum, snare drum is doing boom chap, boom chap, boom chap, boom chap. That's the heartbeat of the march. Heartbeat is inside, it's not outside. You cannot see your heart outside bumping like that. So we go to boom chap, boom chap, boom chap, and then the brass and winds will hate us forever. So if you're playing marches, yes, although the part might be saying F, F or F, know that you are the heartbeat. Sometimes you come up to complement them. Let's say the cymbals can complement them for the more contrasting. But chang, 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 then ch, 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 ch.
Yeah.
So it's like. And then they could play da, 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 whatever. Yeah. Nobody have to blast their lungs out. But then, like, let's say if you are playing like Shostakovich, like orchestral stuff, you are playing war stuff, or let's say you are playing a piece that. The drum is depicted as the war or the monster, or the timpani have to play the thunderstorm. Of course, the thunder is a right? It's going to be like, I got to play a good tone and compliment. No, you are the star there. So that's your show off time.
Context,
yeah, so know
really
your role.
Yes.
Absolutely. All right. Another commonly asked question, and I think it's quite important that we actually address these issues. We've sort of kind of touched on it a bit, is how can I strengthen my weaker hand?
Especially since a lot of us are right-handed, and a lot of the music that's written, we start with our right hand. Like what you say, all the roles, we usually just sound on the right hand, but we usually really neglect our left hand. So what tips would you guys give for students to really strengthen their left hand?
Lead with your left hand.
Yeah.
So you can find like a simple exercise. Just start with a simple exercise and then do slowly with your big hand, and then you speed it up. Okay, so and then now you feel like okay, that's okay. Okay, so when you play with your strong hand, your big hand will follow what the strong hand does. Now you turn that role over. So the weak hand will lead the strong hand.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So this is one of the like a mind thingy going on. So the strong hand will follow what the lead hand, what the weak hand does. Yeah. Yeah. So just and then it will like balance it out actually. Yeah.
So yeah.
So like
any tips and tricks as
yeah, like I mean like maybe let's say we are playing a piece in school band, a snare drum piece, and then all our sticking start with right hand, and then don't do it during rehearsal because you might screw up. Take the same exercise, start with left hand, or play the entire thing with left hand but slower by maybe one third of it, go slower, just for fun now, play everything with left hand. Like let's say you have a rhythm, like let's say you will do right, left, right. Then you, in your own practice time, you do left. Oh, you play. It might be slower because it's your hand, right? Then just do it slower, put on metronome, push the tempo up, and then go back to your rehearsal if you feel adventurous and ready. Then you put your left hand and see whether you will finish them not or not.
So, okay, taking
I
so
in my work situation, I only do it in my practice to strengthen my not so strong hand. But also, pick any exercises, right? Let's say even though you have a method book, it says, this is an exercise of right, left. Do it the other way. Feel free to change anything. You can use the same one page and create 10 different exercises out of it, hundreds, whatever.
All right, that's really really interesting perspective. Okay, now moving on to our final main topic for today's session. It's actually instrument maintenance. I know for percussion instruments, there's not much, unlike wind instruments, we have to wipe out the saliva and the condensation and stuff. What do percussionists actually do after when you play? Do you wipe down anything? Do you
especially because our percussion instruments are very very expensive, even to compared to big instruments like the tuba or the trombone. So we usually want to take good care of it so that if it won't spoil easily.
Yeah.
So maybe Nian Shee, you want to share a few tips?
So I'll keep my stuff away, like put it inside my mallet bag, and then keep the temporary triangles and all that back to the where it is stored. Yeah, so as for me, my home, so I'll have a dehumidifier to set inside my room. So I'll like just like change the water like when it is full. Yeah, so to make sure that the humidity is like not too high or not too low. Yeah.
So would you think that a dehumidifier is very important for schools if they do have percussion instrument like marimba or glockenspiel?
Yeah.
Yes.
What is the purpose of putting one of the dehumidifier in the as in how does it help to maintain this the condition of the instrument?
So it will help the temperature and the humidity. Like sometimes it gets hot like in the room during the day, and then it will get humid, and then the dehumidifier will do the job.
Because Malaysia is a very humid country. I think our humid level is like 97
plus,
which is not friendly to instruments, especially the concert instruments, because most of them are built really in like the places with seasons which are drier, so it's not friendly for us. So if possible, like if the school band can allow a room to have aircon all the time, keep the marimba, like those things that will get moldy inside. Because like for marimba, if you have a rosewood, for xylophone, if you have a rosewood instrument, you don't want it to get spoiled because of the humidity. And rosewood is not allowed to be cut anymore. That's why if you break it out, bye-bye.
Oh, no.
But the thing is, they are very pricey. So, and also you see like having the aircon on 24/7 is pretty much impossible for most of us, especially for school bands, like government school bands. So a dehumidifier will be more helpful, it's cheaper, and it take away the water particle from the air. It reduces the humidity. It reduces the chances of your instruments getting molded, getting out of tune. Yeah.
What about for school bands that actually have timpani? So after you've played the timpani, right? How what is the best optimal way to actually, you know, to leave it in what state? Do you like, you know, release the pedal or
middle range of the drummer? For me, you agree? Because there are different thoughts of school.
Also, you guys just put it in the middle rather than all the way down.
If the drum head is too loose all the time, that means it's very hard to tighten it again later on. So your pitch will eventually drop. If you keep it, wait, is it that way or the other way or something like that? Yeah. Or if you keep it tightest all the time, then it's very hard. I forgot. Like,
it will stretch out.
Better
and
then you can't stretch it anymore.
If you stay down, it also drop. So if you keep it in the middle, you can still go up and still go down. I mean, that's the way I understand it. And I always have your head covered. Don't use your instrument as a table.
It's true. Yeah.
What about for mallets? Because especially like marimba mallets and vibraphone mallets, they are very expensive, upwards of 100 or 200 ringgit per pair. What tips would you guys have for students to keep them in a state that they will last for many, many years? Maybe Nian Shee?
I have like a silica pack inside my mallet bag and my instrument is back. Silica pack. It's easy to get.
Then so this is like after, you know, putting our instruments there, right? So what if a band has to travel with percussion instruments? How would you advise them to pack their instruments to make sure, you know, it's being delivered in the safest state.
Yeah, especially safe. For like East Malaysian bands, when they have to fly over to West Malaysia for a competition, what tips would you guys give them so that the instrument won't be spoiled during transport?
What instruments are you going to bring?
Like marimba or vibraphone, like this. Yeah.
You have to bring those instruments over. You can't use the ones there.
Because it really depends on the competition organizer. I've seen some bands whereby they have to bring the whole pit section and bring to the competition place. So like if that really is possible, if that really is necessary, what tips would you guys have? Or even from like the school to like a concert venue.
So even within local travels.
Okay, so I'll say if the school is rich,
the bag.
That's a hard case.
Hard case.
The school is not rich,
If the school is not rich, you can use towels, sponge, wrap it up. Wrap it up and then put individual different parts like individually. Like, so for example, snare drum, it's snare drum only. And then for like xylophone, you need to take everything down, right? So the bars you wrap the bars by itself alone. And then the other part, the black keys, and then there are also like legs and the wheels and all that. So you pack individually. It's a lot of work and
What about mallets? Do you put them, you would advise to put them in a mallet bag, right?
Yes.
But what if
bring
it's
it
like...
with
yourself. You bring it yourself, you don't put it in the
bring
closet.
Bag. Yes.
But what about if it's the all the mallets in the school, like how would you advise them to keep it in the bedroom, like in the individual mallet bag, or like if they have a lot of mallets, what would you suggest for them to do?
I can show you what I keep here. I put them in different bins, but then I mean my sticks are pretty much in good condition.
That's a lot.
These are all my marimba, microphone stuff. I mean, like, I have different bins for different stakes. That's all. Because it's easier to see and keep things out. And then I got this idea from Tan Su In.
Shout out.
Shout out.
The round one works well, better than the one that is square.
Oh, you mean the basket?
Yeah.
Is that what you do as well, Nian Shee?
Yes.
Also a basket?
We all went shopping together.
This is like my
Yeah. So she bought the red basket, you bought the transparent basket.
I'll just take the red one out.
All right. Okay. Yeah, so that was really, I hope you guys learned a lot from what the panel has just discussed. But unfortunately, this is the end of part one. Now we will upload a summary for you to take down some notes. And if you have any questions, just ask them in the comment section below. We'll answer them after the summary has been taken down, okay? Otherwise, we'll still have even more questions that a lot of students have asked us before when we visited bands, and we'll bring them up to the panel for them to be answered. All right, see you in 5 minutes. All right, welcome back to our question and answer session. So we've just got a question that came in. It's a difficult question to answer since none of us have the equipment.
Yeah.
How to tune a bass drum? Ninji, do you want to give, what do you think on how to tune a bass drum?
So the technical part will be the same as the snare drum, that make sure that all of the knots are like the same, right? The pressure, tension, yeah. The lux, same tension. So, but for me, I would say that the back, so the non-hitting surface, the back will be, the pitch will be lower than the hitting one.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm.
Why is that solely? Why do you usually tune it like that?
So that sort of will get that a deep sound from the bass drum. Yeah. Okay. So why we call it a bass drum? Because we want the bass sound. We don't it will become like a low tom or what? Yeah. So we need a lower deep sound to support the bass. Mm. Yeah. So not too tight. If not, it would be like a floor tone. Yeah, it's not a bass drum.
Yeah.
Sian?
I have a good news to share. I just went on YouTube and typed how to tune a concert bass drum. Look, guys. Go for it. I mean, like, not that we don't want to share. It's because we don't have a bass drum and that each drum is different. So people will have to, you guys will have to explore with different drum. We would say the general rule is the hitting surface is higher pitch than the non-hitting surface. But it might be a different case for your drum. Because we are not touching a drum, we do not know. So like, keep the general rule is just keep your surface same pitch. Oops, sorry. Now it's the YouTube videos, they have a real drum set, like the ones that are made by Rick First. You know, they are made by real, working percussionists, professional percussionists, and with a real drum there, so you can have a better idea, and then try it on your drum. If it doesn't work, then try it a different way. Yeah, it might not work. Most probably it works, but it might not. Yeah.
Right. Experiment, guys. Experiment. Mm. With guidance.
Guidance.
Your guidance.
Don't make your band director shout at you.
Exactly. Definitely not. All right. Okay. So this next one is a bit. I think it's pretty self-explanatory. But I think a lot of bands in Sarawak are currently going through that phase. So the question is: do I really have to learn how to read music scores? Can I just play by ear? Nianqi, what do you think?
The answer is very obvious.
If you can read the music, that's the best because you can play a lot of music. If you just learn by ears, let's say for a year you only play two songs, you can only play two songs in a year. If you learn how to read the music, you can play as many as you want. Yeah.
Sian, did you started with learning how to read notes as well in your band?
I started as a pianist.
Okay.
I would say because some people who are watching might not be a percussionist in a school band, it might be a percussionist for maybe a Latin percussion band or playing jazz. Yeah. People playing in pop, they don't necessarily read music. Because they have a different way, like let's say for jazz, they read lead sheet and then they improvise. That's a different scale that I don't have. I wish I have. Yeah, so if you are in that field, you don't read music, it's fine. That's the nature of your field. But if you are in like concert percussionist, you want to be a marching band percussionist, I would say strongly recommend to read, because if you are just listening and play, the person who taught you might be playing the wrong thing. Always best to go back to the primary source. Like just like when we nowadays, people like when we talk about news, we heard a lot of auntie uncle tell us all this news. Always go back to the video that the prime minister is talking. That's the
one.
Don't just listen to people telling you they got to talk about. So really? It's the same group.
That's really good advice.
Yeah. So if you can read, you can testify the part, and then you can tell that you are playing what the composer is writing.
Exactly. Because in the end, that is what we do. We write what the composer wants us to play.
Yes.
And we play what the composer wants us to play. Yeah.
Right.
We are playing their brainchild, I would say. With our touch of, because we know the instruments better, we might have taste slightly different, then we can spice it up. But then we don't change what the composers write most of the time.
Yeah.
Have to respect that, because they compose. If you don't want to play what they write, then write your own music.
Exactly. All right, let's turn back to one of our auxiliary topics. Given that we have a bit of time to talk about that, let's talk about stick and mallet selection. One common question is, why do percussionists have so many different types of mallets?
So this will be going back to the question the topic that we talk about, the tone. So you will need like different sticks or mallets to get what you want.
What are the basic kind of materials that you know are made of? So maybe let's just talk about glockenspiel. So most bands probably have that glockenspiel in their school. What are the common kind of sticks you know that you guys use?
The common one.
As you can see, our musicians here have an extensive collection of mallets.
Which is the white basket as well.
Start with general. Start with something that can play general, like can go soft, can go loud, can control and make the sound somewhat like a soft mallet, can hit louder and somewhat make a harder sound. General stick. Mine is master something. Forgot what. This one can play on glockenspiel and xylophone. That's my first pair of glockenspiel mallet.
What is the material of the head?
Phenolic.
Oh, phenolic, okay.
Phenolic is a type of plastic, right? It's a hard plastic.
Yeah, and then eventually you will need, for glockenspiel, right, you will need metal stick. So that's because our composer asked for it most of the time. They would say metal sticks or brass mallets. So get a pair first. If you have
the multiple
get one
metal
more
ones.
Yeah, eventually, like let's say you have to play like a toy thing, then get a smaller one.
Then
eventually you build your library. I got my magical sound one. Then I got my bird sound one, whatever. That's like if you have the financial possibilities to do that. Or else, because like last time back then, like when these mallets are not invented, percussionists, they have one pair of mallets and then they use it for everything. We are living in a world that we have too many things to choose from. So we forgot to how to use the same, because it's like the mallet is only helping you. The way you play is the one that make it sound different. So like grab a pair of general mallet, experiment with it. I mean, unless like for, let's say the composer asks for brass mallet, then you cannot use this one. I mean, you can, but this is
ideally
what he's asking for. Ideally, just get one like different material ones, and then use this one, experiment sound. Like, let's say you have to play a soft tone. Then you just practice softly, loudly, and then try to play scales. Have fun with this, and eventually you'll find out, one pair of mallet can do a lot of things. You definitely do not need this much in a school bag. You'll have the money to go for it. But then when you have these many selections, remember you have to experiment with them, because these are just the tools. You are the one who making sound.
What about Nishi? Nishi, what, like, so you have, it seems that you have a bit fewer mallets as compared to Syria. Yeah. Do you, if a band, in a band setting, what are the recommended, few type of materials that is commonly used for glockenspiel? So, like the general one, right?
Yeah, the general one, the one with the phenolic plastic thing. And if you can get a brass mallet for the metal. And also, I would also say also get a rubber mallet. Some composers do require you to play with the rubber mallets to get like a soft, soft sound. And you can also practice with the rubber mallet. You don't want to hurt your ears by playing.
Yeah.
Metal for 1 hour is not, it's bad for your ears.
True.
Yeah, get an ear plug or practice with the rubber or do both.
Okay. Is this just a request from me, but are you able to demonstrate the different sounds? Like, so just three. Yeah, since you have a glockenspiel feel behind.
Okay. Yeah. I'll try. So this is the general one of the gear and metals. Yeah. I have a smaller stick.
Oh.
Smaller stick. And then the one with the magical sound, I just got it.
What is the magical sound? Very curious. What is the magical sound?
Magical mallet, very pricey. Right? It's from Fear Percussion.
Okay, so we start with the general one.
Don don dan puan-puan, kita akan mendarat.
Why, Anna?
So I'll try with the smaller stick.
Smaller
stick.
Mm. Yeah.
Smaller head, okay?
Oh.
So it's like a brighter, more delicate sound.
Yes, yes. Mm. Okay, and now I'll try with the metal. So this is the brass or aluminium.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty, it's heavier than those.
It's more in your face.
Yeah, yeah. It has like a bright and strong and
strong
sound. Okay, now with the magical one.
Magical.
Wait, does it sustain slightly longer? I can't really tell.
Yeah, I think it does.
Because we are listening through internet, like through different devices.
Yeah.
The sound is definitely, this is like a discounted version, I would say.
Discounted version.
Yeah, so this is just a very brief idea. If you have a chance, like let's say if you go to like a band festival or anything, like different percussionists, different schools might have different sticks.
Hmm.
I would say maybe for future band festivals or things like that, maybe you guys can arrange a time that all percussionists bring out all their sticks, everybody try everything, then you would know what works. Yeah, because we are all living in a country that is very hard for us to buy percussion mallets. They do have places like that to sell instruments but and mallets, but we don't normally get a chance to try them.
Exactly.
And then
yeah.
we just say like, oh, the teacher say buy that one, then I buy that one. I mean, like, that doesn't really do justice to, like, is that the sound you want?
Yeah.
So the best is arrange a session, get all the mallets out, everybody try everything, then see what you like, though.
Yeah, I think this is very useful, especially some shop owners, they don't necessarily let you try out the mallets or they don't have instrument in the shop to let you actually see, hear and hear what's the sound.
You know what? Percussion store in Sydney can try that.
There's one newly open percussion store in KL, you can do that. With instruments.
Okay. Shout out, what's your social media? What's it? We can put them
percussion store, right?
Yeah, it's Pasar Seni.
Okay.
You can take a model there.
The yellow background with the
upstairs
one. Okay, so maybe we can leave that.
Yeah, in
the
comments.
We can
find out the link. Yeah, I mean, like there are also places like JS Music, Bentley Music. They have they sometimes do let you try if they have the instruments in the shop.
For Sarawak, give it another 60 years, maybe.
Sorry,
it will come. It will come.
Somebody open a shop there.
Not yet.
Open a second shop.
All right. Do we have time for one last question? I think Terrence has a question. Yeah.
So one of the questions that a lot of students have been asking lately is, especially during this quarantine MCO period, what can I do to help improve my skills during this lockdown period? So maybe what specifically do you guys suggest that they practice?
Mm-mm.
General.
Because a lot of students don't have their instruments with them now.
Yeah.
Maybe at most they have a pair of drumsticks. Yeah. Should they be doing body percussion? I don't know.
you can do whatever you want, actually.
Yeah, I mean, look for resources. Like, if you have internet, go on YouTube. There are so many people, even more people now putting out free lessons and materials. Go and watch them. More like explore things. If you have a pair of sticks and a pad, and then look for material online, start practicing, or take out the exercises that maybe your teacher gave you before MCO. Mm-hmm. And then maybe your teacher say, play it this way. Then you make it a homework for yourself to find out like 10 different ways to use it. Like, let's say, for example, I'm sure some of, do you guys get this piece of paper? The picture?
Those who went to QIBF, Nianxi gave this out as a handout.
Yeah,
could be in your emails.
Yeah, so let's say if you have this exercise or any exercise, let's say like it's rhythm or mati, tika ti, tika ti, tika ti, right? So you can do it right-handly, right, left, right, right, left. You can do it left-handly, left, left, right. You can do it alternatively, right, left, right. Or you can do it soft, you can do it loud. You see five ways already. You can do it double stroke, right, left, right. Or you can double all your semi quiver and make it a five stroke row exercise. Or you can do it, you see, like you name it, you make it an accent exercise. You accent all the first beat, you accent all the quiver beat, you accent all the last semi quiver. You can use just your finger to play this into your lines, use all your wrist, just wrist, use arm only, make it a row exercise. What else? Like row, you can go loud row, soft row. You see, like just by saying, I'm sure I've like so many ways. Just don't be like blinded, be just one line. Like play with this. One pitch, I'm sure this will last you for a long time. And it'll help you to build many different scales.
Yeah. Just so you know, guys, the link to the document that Sirian was talking about is actually in the comment section below, so you guys can download. It's called the Mitchell Peters.
Yeah.
And there's also preparation for double stops in
from
there.
This book. All right.
Yeah. Also, I think Nianxi and Sirian are both teaching online, so if you want lessons, you can find them in there with their social media link down below as well. Yeah. just a shout out. All right.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, I think that's all the time that we have for this session. All right. Thank you so much, Nianxi and Suyen. I think it's been a really energetic and motivational session for everyone. We hope that this session has also been informative and helped all the viewers learn more about the instrument that you're playing. So if you like what we've been doing, please give us a thumbs up and follow us as well as the panelists today on their social media. Also, let us know in the comment section below how we can improve and what kind of other activities you would like to see from us in the future. All right. Finally, make sure that you look out for our next session that will be happening tomorrow. For the flute class, it was initially 8:30 p.m., but now it has been changed to 7:30 p.m. All right. So that's all we have for today. Thank you and see you next time.
Bye.